10 questions to ask your mortgage brokers. Is there a fee for your services?
Can I get pre-approved for a mortgage?
How does the mortgage approval process work?
Should I go with a variable or a fixed rate?
How can I save on interest?
What kind of prepayment privileges do I have with my mortgage?
What kind of penalty am I looking at if I want to restructure my debt?
What kind of closing costs should you expect?
Is this a standard or collateral charge?
Are there any restrictions on refinancing my mortgage?
Hey everyone, welcome back to the Canadian Real Estate Channel. Today you've got Adam J.D. Martin here to introduce you to another Findlay Finance Friday. And today we're talking about the top questions to ask your mortgage agent before you go and get that financing. This is one of the most important people in your power team, so you want to know the right questions to ask before you get that commitment letter. Let's jump right in and see what the Findlay Mortgage Team has to say about that.
Hey guys, in today's video, we're going to talk about the 10 questions to ask your mortgage broker. So Ehren and I are going to be breaking down some of the top questions that we get asked every single day in regards to attaining a mortgage, how to get one, the costs involved, and how to scale your portfolio. So we're going to break down top 10 that we get every single day, starting with number one. Is there a fee for your services? We get this question all the time, probably the most asked question. So we wanted to break down exactly how this works and when you don't have to pay for anything and when you do have to pay. So usually what happens is conventional lenders, so the big five lenders, you know, our monoline lenders, AAA lenders, they pay us to bring them really good business. So if you guys have great credit, provable income, can qualify with your GDS-TDS ratios in line, there's no cost to you whatsoever. Our service is free to you because you have phenomenal, you know, a phenomenal package, and lenders want to work with you. Now, when it comes to B lenders are solutions-based. So if you are in the bracket of a B lenders, you either are trying to scale your portfolio because your income ratio is no longer meet the AAA lending box, or you have maybe a bruised credit, or you're trying to fix your situation to get back into A lending. Now for this, there are some fees involved. There's usually a 1% lender fee and a 1% broker fee. If you're doing a refinance, we can roll those fees into your loan, but if you're doing a purchase, this is something that's going to come out of your cost of acquisition. Last but not least, private lending. Private lending can range between 1 to 2% for a lender fee and usually 1 to 2% for a broker fee. There are some times where those fees can be a little bit more depending on the complexity and the size of the deal. Really important to note that these private mortgage solutions are not long-term solutions. They're there to be able to help you graduate into either selling a property or moving into an A or B solution.
Okay, so question number two that we get most often is, can I get pre-approved for a mortgage? So pre-approvals can be a great tool to, you know, figure out where you're currently sitting with your affordability based on some generic expenses. The pre-approvals really only work on the A side for A side lenders and for owner-occupied properties. So for the investors out there who are looking to get rentals or purchase something on the B side, there are no pre-approvals for those types of situations. It is only for an owner occupied. So it is a little bit limited, but again, if you're just looking to get into the market and you haven't done any research, starting off with that pre-approval and just figuring out what your current affordability is can be a great way to start your investing or purchasing process.
It's really important to note that pre-approvals are not underwritten by the bank. So it's on the onus of your mortgage broker to be able to assess all of your documents up front to ensure that we're using the correct and accurate information to give you the most accurate pre-approval that you can have. Also, something really important to note is we usually don't factor in condo fees in your pre-approval unless you specifically have a condo that you're looking at and we can input the exact amount. So condo fees, we have to use 50% of that overall monthly fee into your debt servicing. So a pre-approval may not be 100% accurate as to what you can actually afford. Question number three, how does the mortgage approval process work? So it's not super complicated, but there are a few steps involved. Step number one is just having a conversation. You're gonna wanna talk to your mortgage broker, let them know what your short-term goals are, what your long-term goals are, and how you're going to move through the process. So essentially, we're going to need to know your income, we're gonna need to know your credit, and we're gonna need to know your down payment. And once we have a firm grasp of what that looks like, we can start with a pre-approval. Once you have a pre-approval, you can start to look at a property, or if you already have a property in mind, make an offer on that property. After you have an offer on the property and it's accepted, this is when the real work happens. You essentially give us the approval, we take a look at the MLS, we have a conversation with a few lenders to figure out which property product is right for you. Now, we'll already have your documents on file. So what we need to do is submit those documents, have a conversation with the lender, get your mortgage commitment back, and we'll have a conversation about what that commitment looks like, some of the prepayment privileges, what your rate's gonna be, and how you're gonna move forward until you have to close in the transaction. Once all the conditions are satisfied on our side, your lawyer's gonna be in touch with you to go through some of the conditions on their side. And once closing day happens, you get your keys and you're a proud owner of a new building.
Yeah, something to note on that is if you're looking to do a small commercial type file, the process can be slightly different. Whereas on the residential side, you're going to get a commitment from a lender within 3 to 5 business days. The commitment on a small commercial or large commercial comes after we've done all the due diligence and the report. So, you know, if you need a building condition report and an appraisal, we're not going to get that final loan agreement until maybe 4 to 5 weeks in through the process. They're going to issue you a letter of direction or a proposal, maybe within 3 to 5 business days, that just outlines, based on some initial looks, here's where we're at rate and term wise and loan to value. If you're okay with that, then we can move forward with the process. So just understanding the condition of financing date can be quite different for a commercial versus a residential property.
That's a great point. Now, commercial versus residential financing is completely different. Sometimes you might not even get a commitment up until maybe 7 to 5 days before closing if you're working with a conventional or monoline lender on a commercial property. There's so much due diligence that has to go into underwriting some of these larger deals. Understanding your condition to financing and when you can waive those conditions is super important depending on the type of asset you're looking to purchase or refinance.
Mm-hmm. Question number 4, and this is a really good question, especially right now with the environment that we're in, is should I go with a variable or a fixed rate? The one thing that you're going to realize with real estate is that there is no one solution fits all. There's going to be pros and cons in each situation. So fixed and variable rates are based off of 2 different factors. The fixed rate is based off of the bond market, while the variable rate is based off of the Bank of Canada's overnight lending rate. Now, coming out of COVID, we've had obviously a quite different economy than what we've seen in the past. Fixed rates have been on the rise over the last month and a half, just due to the bond market kind of altering its numbers already based off the way the economy is going. So fixed rates are currently up right now. Variable rates are slowly kind of catching up. Bank of Canada has come out and said that they are hoping to see some correction to the overnight lending rate by 2023. Now, that might be a bit of a safe estimate. We could start to see the Bank of Canada's overnight rate go up mid-2022, late 2022. So, you could see your variable rate go up a little bit earlier than suggested by the bank. The next thing you really want to take a look at is what type of exit penalty do you want and what is the situation you're looking to use this for. If you're looking to get a BRRRR and you know you're going to be exiting out of that mortgage in, say, 5 to 6 months or even 1 year on a 5-year term, that variable rate is going to give you the most amount of flexibility on exit. You're going to be looking at a 3 months interest penalty versus on the fixed rate side, you're going to be subject to either the interest rate differential or the 3 months interest penalty. Now, on the fixed rate side, those interest rate differential penalties really depend on the market. If you're in an inclining or a declining market, you may be subject just to the 3 months interest. So it really depends on what type of market you're in. But overall, again, what do you need from your product? Do you want fixed mortgage payments so that you know specifically what your cash flow is going to be? Now, I'd probably take a fixed rate. If you're looking for flexibility in your mortgage and the ease of exiting, no matter where you are in your term, I would probably go ahead and take a variable rate as long as you're okay with those payments fluctuating month to month.
Yeah, great question. We have it all the time, and it really just depends on your investment strategy at the end of the day. Question number 5, how can I save on interest? This is a great question. Some investors are really focused on saving on interest, and some would much rather take a longer amortization and not care about the interest and have higher cash flow. So this is a really interesting question. You can accelerate your payments. So you can have extra payments in an accelerated weekly or biweekly payment frequency. This will allow you to have additional payments or increase your overall amount that you put down over an entire year, which then decreases the amount of interest you pay over time. Second is you can obviously have someone pay the interest for you. So, if you have a renter in there, they're paying your mortgage and you can write off all the interest in your taxes. So you're actually not paying any interest, which is kind of a little bit of a hack if you didn't know. And one of the main reasons why a lot of people buy investment properties.
And again, you know, that's for some of the specific products that we work with on the solutions-based side, you know, that's why we don't necessarily focus on interest rates as much. Yes, it's obviously a key factor in determining what your cash flow is going to be, but having the ability to write that interest off definitely gives you a little bit of room to be able to work with a slightly higher interest rate on these solutions-based products. Question number six is, what kind of prepayment privileges do I have with my mortgage? So there's two basic prepayment privileges that we take a look at. One is a lump sum payment, and the second is the ability to be able to increase your monthly payment on your payment date. Now there's two percentages. Most lenders have a 20-20 prepayment and lump sum type privileges, but there are some lenders that only have 15%. Now depending on, you know, what your financial situation is like and how much free cash you have coming in each month, you know, that 5% difference may not matter to you, but if you're on the path of aggressively paying down your mortgage and getting out as quick as possible, obviously taking advantage of the additional 5% with that 20% prepayment privileges is going to give you the fastest pay down of your mortgage. Now, one thing to kind of note here is if you take a variable rate mortgage, you're actually going to lose that ability to increase your monthly payment, but you will still have your 20% lump sum payment option available for you. So can be great ways to get in and out of your mortgage, really build up that equity in a shorter period of time to be able to take that out and then use that moving forward with your investing ventures.
Yeah, question number seven, what kind of penalty am I looking at if I want to restructure my debt? Ehren kind of touched on this already, so we won't take too long, but essentially a variable rate mortgage comes with a 3-month interest penalty. A fixed rate mortgage usually comes with an interest rate differential. And for anybody who doesn't know, an interest rate differential, essentially what they do is they'll find the rate that is currently on the market. So say you're in a 5-year term, you've done 3 years, you got 2 years left. So you find whatever the 2-year market rate is, or whatever their benchmark is, they'll find what your rate is, they'll find the difference between those two rates, and then multiply it by how many months you have left in your term. And if that amount is more than what your 3-month interest penalty is, that's what you need to pay. And really important to note that some lenders have different benchmark rates. So some will use the contract rate, which is the rate that's currently on the market, and some will use as little as the T-bill rate, which is probably the lowest amount that you can borrow possible. So the difference between those rates can be significant, and that could really change your overall cost to break your loan.
One thing to note, if you have an interest rate differential penalty, is depending on the type of market you're in, you may not actually be subject to that IRD. So if you're in an inclining market, that's gonna give you a negative difference. That means you're actually gonna be subject to that 3 months interest and not the interest rate differential, which can be a huge bonus. Now, obviously, trying to plan that out and relying on that increasing market isn't a great strategy, but just understanding where you are in the market gives you a heads up as to what your exit cost could be. Question number eight, what kind of closing costs should you expect? So there's a few things that are gonna be pretty standard with every single mortgage out there. You're gonna have a lawyer fee on your transaction, whether it's a purchase or a refinance, and which it seems like a silly thing to say, but we do get a lot of questions about refinances and whether or not you do need a lawyer. And anytime you are registering a charge on your property or on title, you do need a lawyer. Now lawyers, their costs can obviously depend on which firm you're going with and the size of the transactions. On a standard residential deal, you know, we estimate it to be around $18,000 to $2,000. We like to give a little bit of a buffer. You know, there are some lawyers who charge less. There might be some lawyers who charge more, but that $2,000 mark is a pretty good estimate. Now, we touched on this a little bit too, but on the lender and broker fees, again, if this is a prime A deal on a 1-4 unit, you know, there is going to be no broker or lender fees for you. That's a free transaction for you. From that fee standpoint, the lenders actually pay us to bring them the prime client, so there is no lender or broker fee for you to worry about. Now, when we move on to the B side or onto the small commercial and commercial side, there are going to be lender and broker fees. So on the Schedule 2 or the B side, there is a 1% lender setup fee and a 1% broker setup fee. That is based off of the loan amount that we originate for you. Now, when we move to the commercial side, whether that's small or large commercial, our broker fee is going to stay the same on these prime deals. So we're at 1% of the loan amount. The commitment fee or the lender fee may change a little bit. On the small commercial side, most lenders charge a quarter of a point. Now they can go up to 1%, but on these smaller, less complex deals, they usually keep it around 25 basis points. Once you start to get into the super large multi-unit or maybe some of these mixed commercial retail type spaces, that commitment fee may change with the complexity of the deal. So just keep that in mind. Now land transfer taxes are gonna be involved on every single purchase that you have. If you are a first time buyer and you do have your land transfer transfer tax credit. That's going to be given to you right at the time of purchase. That'll happen at the lawyer's office. If you're not taking advantage of that because you've already used it, then you're going to be paying that tax out of pocket on closing. Now, something to keep in mind with the land transfer tax is, depending on where you're purchasing the property, you may be subject to an additional cost. So areas such as Toronto actually have two land transfer tax. So they have the provincial and the municipal tax, which can obviously double end you there and will increase your cost on closing. So just keep that in mind. The last thing that we want to take a look at are some of the reports that you may need for your purchase. On these basic residential deals, you're just going to need an appraisal. If it's an insured purchase, you might be lucky and just have an AVM model where the insurer covers that and there is no charge for you. If it's an uninsured purchase on the A or the B side, you're going to have a standard appraisal cost of around $450 to $500, depending whether or not you need that market rent addendum. Now, there can be some other reports that you may need as well, depending on the type of property you're purchasing. So if it's a large multi or a retail type building, you might need an environmental or a building condition report. And the cost for your appraisal is definitely going to go up. So instead of being at that $500, you might be closer to $18,000 to $2,000. And each report is actually in and around that cost. So overall, if you need all three reports, you're probably looking around $6,000 plus tax to get those reports done.
Yeah, number nine. Is this a standard or collateral charge? Really important things to understand, not a whole lot of people understand them. A standard charge is exactly how it sounds. If a bank is going to give you a loan, they're going to register exactly the amount of the loan they're going to give you on title. Now, collateral charge, most banks who use collateral charges will collateralize up to 125% of the loan amount on title. This allows you to have access to the growing equity in your home without having to re-register the loan on title. One of the disadvantages of a collateral charge is you don't have access to any of the equity in your property while you're in the term. Meaning if you were looking to throw a second mortgage on, you wouldn't be able to do it because the lender had already collateralized the entire value of the property. So when you're looking to structure your financing with a conventional lender, understand, is this a collateral or mortgage charge? It might help you down the road if you need quick access to the equity for your next purchase.
Mm-hmm. And one thing to add in there quick is that you don't have to pay this additional percentage that they add on. This is just, it's just collateralized. So when you go to pay out, if you wanted to refinance or sell, you only pay out what is actually registered as the mortgage and not the additional collateral. Last point, number 10, is, are there any restrictions on refinancing my mortgage? Topic number one in there is a bona fide sale clause. So again, this comes down to understanding the type of mortgage that you have. There are some lenders out there who in their mortgage commitments have something called a bona fide sale clause, which means that there is no ability to exit out of that mortgage early unless you're actually selling your property. So if you're an investor and you're looking to bury your property, make sure that's not in there, because being able to refinance out, is not gonna be an option. You're gonna be stuck in that mortgage until you sell it. Now, if this is a 1-year term, after that 1-year term is up, that bona fide sale clause matures with your commitment. You can then exit out freely without the cost of breaking and refinancing another mortgage. But if you get into a 5-year term and you have that bona fide sale clause, you're gonna be stuck in that mortgage for 5 years. So, that's something that can be, if it's not disclosed to you, that really ties in all of your cash and your equity for the next 5 years. That can really hinder your ability to move forward as an investor with all your capital tied up.
Yeah, and it's kind of like a bait and switch. So really keep in mind what kind of product you're going to be getting when you talk to your mortgage broker. Those 0.99% or those 1.3% mortgages that are bare bones mortgages have those bona fide sale clauses in there. So the 0.3% basis points that you're going to be saving, or the $20 on your mortgage payment, really isn't worth being handcuffed into your mortgage, especially if you're an investor and you're trying to scale.
Yeah, and it's not necessarily a bad thing to have. It's very situational, right? We're not saying there's terrible products, but just make sure and that you are aware, if you have the bona fide sale clause, be okay that you're going to be in that mortgage for a year. And if that's okay with you, that mortgage commitment still may work for you, but just understanding what that means and what that means for you moving forward. The next thing is an interest rate differential or a 3-month penalty. We've kind of talked about this a little bit, but basically what are you looking at in terms of exiting out of your mortgage, and what is it going to cost cost you. If you're in a 3 months interest penalty on a variable rate, you're gonna have that minimal cost to get out, and it's gonna be the most amount of flexibility you're gonna have in your mortgage. If you're in a fixed rate and you're, you know, subject to an interest rate differential or a 3 months interest, the majority of the time you're gonna be subject to that interest rate differential, and it can be quite more costly than what that 3 months interest penalty can be. If you're in a project and the equity you're looking to take out is maybe only $30,000 or $40,000, and you find out you're subject to a $10,000 or $15,000 IRD penalty, that instantly eats away at 50% of that equity, and that can really limit what you're doing moving forward. So that's one of those things where you have to have that initial discussion with your broker, making sure you're getting into the right type of product ahead of time to avoid any of these issues down the road moving forwards.
Yeah, guys, these are only 10 of questions that we hear on a daily basis. If you guys have any questions and you need some answers, feel free to reach out to Ehren and myself or leave them in the comment section below. We really appreciate it if you hit the like button, hit the subscribe button. We're trying to grow our following and give you guys as much value as possible. Thanks so much for your time. We will see you guys again next week.
Thanks, guys.
Alrighty, guys, I hope you guys learned something about what questions to ask your mortgage agent. I know this can be tricky, but it's all there for you, and there's actually a lot of Findlay Finance Friday videos you can go back and watch to actually learn everything that you need to know before you get into that property, before you get the commitment letter. So please, guys, go down, get their information below, and do not forget to like and subscribe so that we can reach more viewers like you and spread this information.